another edition to the Enlightened Ignorance Podcast. I'm your host, J.Burnside. And again, once again, I'm by myself. Devion will be out this week, but I'm sure he's going to go back up and running, or come back up and running. That's the right word for it. Come back next week. But, you know, like I always say, we're going to keep moving, going to keep pushing. But, dang, man. It's been a crazy week. I'm going to turn myself up real quick. It's been a crazy week, by God. Well, take that back. It has been a crazy week. I feel like it's been a normal week. And you know, life is life. And, you know, you got to go through what you go through. And we all try to struggle to survive. So that's what I feel like we're doing, everybody. We feel like we all try to survive. But let me get to the stories or the topics I wanted to say or talk about. For the first story, I necessarily want to talk about a very special person, a woman that I keep defending against my best friend / co-host all the freaking time about who looks better. But today, I gotta say something different. But it's about Tinashe. Now, anybody don't know who Tinashe is? Tinashe is a R&B artist. Don't know where she's from, but she been in the game for a good minute. Dropping tracks from time to time. She has did collabos with many different artists, including Chris Brown, and so on and so forth. And recently, she had an interview. Don't know what the interview was about, but it led to her feeling like that she is not accepted in the black community, and because she's mixed, that's why the black community doesn't support her and all of that. And that kind of stirred up a lot of controversy. It ticked off some people for her to necessarily say that, to say she's not accepting the black community, that's why she don't have the success as a Beyonce or a Rihanna. And she feels like just because she's mixed, that's why the black community don't accept her. I beg to differ. I really beg to differ, because here's what I don't understand when it comes. This is one thing an artist should never ever do. I feel like the artist should never point fingers at the audience for her lack of success. A lot of artists do blame their label. A lot of artists do blame their managers. A lot of artists blame their team. And that's all normal. That happens plenty of times. But one thing I feel like you should never ever do is necessarily start pointing the blame on your fans for your lack of success. And me, I feel like she's a good, decent artist, and she's got a decent fan base, but I don't know why she's necessarily complaining. And I thought about it, and I thought maybe because she feels like she deserved to be in the top tier of R&B artists right now, like the top tier of a Beyonce, Rihanna, and she feels like she's supposed to be in that position right now. As much as she work, as much as she perform, as much as she bust her butt every single day, you know, she felt like she deserved to be in that rank. And for some people, that's laughable, and some, for me, it's like, I can get why you feel that way, especially when you fully believe in yourself and believe in your music and believe in your artistry. When you feel like you are the best, of course you're gonna, you know, say, yeah, I should be in that top tier with the with, with the female artist that's running the world right now. And it so happens that Rihanna and Beyonce is running the world right now for at least black R&B. But that's not them. That's like not black R&B alone. Just R&B, just in general. I mean, that's all the top two, you know, that actually does this thing. And I feel like this is an artist, and she's like any other artist. She's like frustrated, especially when you're in a slump like that. Me, I never thought that she would get pissed off at anybody for her lack of success. But then again, I thought about it. I think she necessarily had this incident about a year or two ago. I think it was 2015 or 2017. No, not 2015, 2017. 2015, 2016. That she basically, you know, went on a rant that no one buys her shit, no one buys her albums, no one buys her projects, no one comes to, you know, support her and all that. And I do feel bad for her, because I think she is a talented artist. I think she just I don't know if she's necessarily missing something, or she has a problem with connecting the fans, you know. But I mean, think about this. She's not the only one, necessarily. You know, there's plenty of artists that has necessarily slumps or feel like they should be in the position to be in the top position, but they're not. But the difference is, I don't see them complaining. I don't see them whining. I don't know. No, I'm take that back. Rewind it again for the umpteenth time. I'm rewinding it every day. Dude, I rewind everything I say for some reason. I don't know why. But to the artists like a Janae or a Kalani or a SZA or any other artists that I did not mention, I mean, these are women that are very talented and bring out and pull out good music. I mean, I listened to SZA's album. I think SZA's album was phenomenal, and I think it was really, really dope. Probably one of the top, got to be one of the top tier R&B albums came out this year by far. But that's besides the point. But they never pointed fingers at the audience. Of course, they pointed. Some you can say, because I remember the incident with SZA, that she just, you know, with the whole label and shit, because I know that story and whatnot, but they never really blamed their fans, you know. And for Tinashe to do that, man, she had to be either super frustrated, or she trying to figure out reasons of why she's not in the position that she wants to be in. But it takes time, man. If you fully believe in yourself and fully believe in your craft, keep going, keep pushing, keep doing what you love to do. And that's about the music. And me as an artist, I wouldn't even give an F when I'm, you know, performing for 30 people at a small venue. Dude, you make music because you love to make music. You make songs because you love to make songs. You make beats because you love to make beats. When you start pointing at the audience, or yeah, this in general, I will say that, make that in life. Put that in a life perspective. I mean, you can't get to where your destination if you start pointing at people. You can't blame people because you're in a position you can't get mad at a person that you're in a position that you are, but you want to be, and you start blaming them. That's not, no. Here's how I feel like Tinashe should do. I think Tinashe needs to look in the mirror. I think she should figure out what's missing in her music to make her feel that way. And I think she just needs to just keep making music. I mean, just do it because it's the love of the music. Don't do it because you feel like, you know, you feel like you should be in a position that you are or you aren't, but and you feel like you should be. But just do it because you love it, man. I'm not saying that she don't love the music. I believe she solely loves music. But at the same time, pointing fingers at an artist is not going to solve, but not an artist, but at the fans or the black community, it's not a necessarily good thing to say or do. So, and of course, it got a little flack for it. I think some Twitter posts feel like it's not because of that. For her to blame on quote unquote colorism, it's just really stupid. Oh, the reason why people just don't fuck with Tinashe is because her music is not good, etc., etc. But yeah, man, Tinashe, keep your head up, keep pushing, keep striving, man. Don't point fingers at anybody. Look at yourself in the mirror and see what's wrong, and just do it because you love to do it. I can get how you will feel that way. I can feel some type of way, like, man, we doing this podcast, you know, I feel like I should be where, you know, the Brilliant Idiots and the Reeds and the other top tier podcasts should be at, man. But, you know, it's going to take time. I don't do it because I want to, you know. Actually, I do. I do want to be one of the top tier podcasters to do, because this is what I love to do. Yes, I don't make sense. Yes, I can hardly speak. Yes, I can't, you know, get to my sentence truly, but I try. I try. Yeah, look, that's a pure example of what I go through. That's one of my big problems. I've been having that since I was little, but I don't stop me. I still up in here, you know, speaking from the heart, saying what I feel, whether people agree with me, whether people disagree with me, that's fine. And I respect them all. But I do this because I love this. And I can just have one person that listens to us and think we're fucking dope. That's fine by me, because this is what we love to do. This is what me and Davion love to do. We love to speak our minds, and we decided let's speak our minds towards the internet. Whether we get millions of views or we get 10 views, we don't care. This is what we love to do. We love to express ourselves, and that's what we're doing. You know, I'm not sitting here blaming people on the internet or people, the fans, or what, like, you know, at home just chilling my damn business, like, why you ain't listening to us, you don't support us, it's because because I'm black, or because I'm this, or A, B, and C. I'm like, no, man, I'm fully believe in my craft, and I firmly believe in Davion's craft that we would get there, you know. But I'm not pointing fingers at nobody at all for me just listen to like one view episode. That's fine, that's cool, because I got one person to listen. And the more and more I frequently drop this shit, the more frequently people is gonna actually listen to us, despite me not speaking fluently, despite of me stammering or stuttering my words, man. I do this because I love this shit. And if I get to that point, if I get to that top tier of podcasting, that's fucking fine. If I don't, that's fucking fine too. But at the end of the day, I still love my shit, and I still believe in my shit. And then that's what me and Davion are. We believe in our craft, and we love what we do. And that's do this shit every single fucking week. Well, not for Davion, because Davion be busy for work, man. He got priorities and shit. So, you know, not to say this is not his priority, but, you know, shit happens. But that's what we firmly believe. So Tinashe wasn't a good choice of words, but I hear what you're saying. But moving on, this okay, so if y'all don't know, Bow Wow necessarily, there's a video of Bow Wow running like hell, and you can actually see girls screaming or running after him towards his tour bus, and you're like, oh shit, oh my god, oh shit. Now, a lot of fans think that Bow Wow paid those people to run after him, and here's my thoughts. It's hard. I can see why people necessarily don't believe in this whole video. You know, I mean, let's look at the track. I mean, if you look at Bow Wow's track record of flawed track record, you can see why he would, well, people wouldn't necessarily think that he paid these artists. I already put him on the list of L's, so I know, you know, he's already in there. But I wouldn't consider this an L because I don't know if it's true or not. But to me, it looks pretty legit. I'm giving Bow Wow the benefit of the doubt. I mean, shoot, no, he's not totally, you know, he's not totally, what's a good word for it? He's not totally, he didn't totally fell off, you know. He still got his core fan bases that used to watch him, listen to his music when they was little and when they was younger, man. I mean, he pissed out some fucking hits. He was one of my favorite artists when I was a kid. You know, but at the generation that happened at that time, so you know. But I believe this is legit. He still have somewhat of a fan base. You still have people that necessarily remember Bow Wow. You still have necessarily people that still appreciate what Bow Wow did, you know, for his age and the music that he dropped and the people that he fucked with, the people that fucked with him, you know. But yeah, I think it's necessarily legit. I'm not surprised if it isn't. At the same time, again, his track record, but I'm again, benefit of the doubt, I think this is legit. I think those are his core fans that just love Bow Wow very much and want to, you know, express his love by running after him and attacking him. I guess so. And I don't know what city he was in for him to, you know, for everybody to necessarily run like hell towards him. But yeah, man. But I don't think that was fake at all. I think that was very real and very very real and very, what's a good word for it? No, just very real. Okay. Sorry guys, but yeah, so Bow Wow, I believe you. I don't think you. And it's funny because I know Off Def Digital says some shit like how much you paid your fans, or how much you paid them to run out to you. And then I think Bow Wow responded, said how much you had to pay Russell to dick ride or something like that. But I thought that was fucking funny. I thought that was funny. Yeah, but yeah, I think it's legit. I think it's legit. Let's see. What else am I missing? Oh, so okay. Since my co-host is not a basketball guy, and I'm a basketball guy. I'm a basketball guy. I'm a pro wrestling guy. Y'all can judge me y'all want to. I don't give a fuck. But as y'all may know, this is a week after the NBA Finals, and the Cavaliers did lose in Game 5 to the Golden State Warriors. But I'm not necessarily surprised that the series ended it quickly. I mean, if you look at the team that, you know, the Warriors had and the team that the Cavaliers had, it was bound to happen. That ring was really coming to the Warriors. I always go for the underdog a lot, so the Cavs I would necessarily was going for, but at the same time, I'm not surprised that the Warriors won. Now this whole, and if y'all listen to First Take, I listen to First Take from time to time, as much of the time I can. I know this whole, you know, LeBron not suiting, you know, not being at a level where like Michael Jordan is. I think we necessarily need to stop that. I think let LeBron be LeBron, let Michael Jordan be Michael Jordan. I think that everybody's just trying to find the next Jordan, and Kobe Bryant and LeBron James at the time was those players to compare to Michael Jordan, because Michael Jordan was so great at what he did, and his legacy, you know, has always been remembered as the greatest player that ever played the sport of basketball. And they just looking for that next Jordan. LeBron and Kobe at the time was those two players. But now Kobe's retired. They Do not, oh, he was the next Jordan. No, Kobe Bryant was Kobe Bryant. Was the next Kobe Bryant. And I feel like that's who it is with LeBron. LeBron doesn't need to be LeBron. And I feel like LeBron is being LeBron. I think they need to stop these comparisons. I get why you want to compare him, but let's stop the comparison. Let LeBron be LeBron James. Let him fit his own legacy. He don't want to be compared as to Jordan. Even though that'd be freaking awesome. Don't get me wrong. I mean, you keep getting compared to Jordan, it's cool at the same time. But you want to put your, you know, make your own stamp in the NBA. You want to make your own legacy, you know. Now you can compare them all you want, but I feel like we need to stop. But as for Kevin Durant, now to me, when he moved to the Warriors, a part of me saw that coming. Only reason why, because think about this. If you're a player and you have an opportunity to join the best, you know, team in the league, and this is just your actual shot to actually win the ring, why not take it? I know people say, yeah, it's the weakest move. It was by far the weakest move. Oh, it was worse than LeBron. Oh, it wasn't compared to LeBron. Blah, 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 blah. But yeah, you know, he ended up winning it, you know? He ended up winning it, and he doesn't regret that shit. I think a lot of people gotta understand. Niggas, a lot of NBA players would do what they gotta do to win a ring. And if this is an opportunity that to join a team that, if you have an opportunity to join a team that is well established, that has good players, that you could depend on when you're fucking up and they can depend on you and they're fucking up, why not take the shot? Why not take the shot, man? I did see it coming. Did it make it right? Not really, you know, but coming from Kevin Durant, I see why he would do that. If you look at a Kevin Durant spot, I'm not nowhere near defending him. I think if he would have stayed with the Thunder, I think they would have, you know, kept pushing. But he was desperate for a ring, man. He had to do what he had to do for a ring. Man, people would do the most for a ring. Because that's what you come for the NBA to do. Come to the NBA, play your best, and win championships. You know, that's what you came here to do. And win as much rings as possible until you cannot play ball any freaking more. So I see why Kevin Durant did what he did. But I can say it was kind of taking the easy way. It was taking the easy way out. It doesn't matter. He got his ring. He's happy. He's probably going to stay with another year with another year with the Warriors. Klay Thompson might be leaving or whatever, but, you know. Yeah, LeBron James already in the gym working out for next year, so he's ready. And he looks more bald than ever. Y'all seen his workout. He looks more bald than ever. He completely shaved his head, so. Completely shaved his head. But, yeah. But congratulations to Warriors, Cavs. Y'all get them next time, you know. Y'all get them next time, guys. And now there's a rumor like Paul George might be gone. Paul George might be actually going to, you know, to the Cavs. Or if not, Carmelo. That'll be a good spot, man. I mean, if you keep the team that you have from the Warriors and you add a Carmelo or a Paul George, that's gonna be a real playoff, you know. I mean, yeah, it'll be, you know, of course the other teams don't really have a chance, but, you know. But I digress. But we see what happens this offseason. Now that the NBA championship is over, the parade is done. LeBron's back at doing it. Warriors soaking this in as much as they can before they get back in the gym working out. So we'll see what happens next year, man. We'll see what happens next year. You know. On the moving on, is there anything else I forgot? I guess no. I'm not gonna talk about the All Eyes on Me movie. Okay, if, by the time y'all listening to this, the All Eyes on Me movie happened, and I don't know what the review is on that movie. So, I want to necessarily see it in theaters, but I know it's gonna be freaking packed every time I try to, every opportunity I try to go. So, I don't know. I'll see what I want to do. I know Jada wasn't too happy about her role in the film. Talking about it was inaccurate, or the relationship between her and Tupac, but she's not, oh my god, I'm so upset kind of way. It was like, nah, y'all got it messed up, but you know, it, not to say it is what it is, but more of, yeah, y'all got it messed up. It's kind of inaccurate between the relationship between her and Tupac. Everything else she didn't say bad about, but just the relationship of how she was portrayed, and the relationship between Jada and Tupac was kind of was inaccurate to her. And you know, but overall, I probably think I believe it's still a good movie despite that. I mean, I don't see anybody else was complaining about that. But the only person was complaining about the movie was Jada, and it was just only about her part on the role of the movie. That's it. So that's it. Okay, so I guess this is gonna be a very short podcast. Very, very short. Let me see if I can pop this up real quick. Now, is this the moment we all been waiting for? I wanted to talk to Devion about this. Real, real talk. But unfortunately, as you can see, he is not here with us. So, anything I'm missing? I don't think I'm missing anything. Talked about that already. Okay, well, let's talk about the last thing. Okay, so now everybody seen it. Everybody saw, and everybody complained. God, there was so much complaints. And I believe y'all know what I'm talking about. It is the XXL 2017 cover. Now, not to my surprise, people saw it and people hated this class. They feel everybody was over here trash, or they say they like this or that person in this class, but they don't like this or that. But mostly negative reviews on this. Mostly negative reviews from what I've seen and heard. And so here's my thoughts on this year's cover. Now, to me, now, as I see this cover and I look at the artist that's in it, most of these artists, I do not know, or I have not listened to, or both. Most of them I have not listened to or heard of. But if y'all check my freshman class prediction, if y'all check my prediction of this year's freshman class, y'all would know that 3 out of the 10 people I picked, 3 out of 10 people I picked that was on my freshman cover ended up being on the cover. If y'all don't know, I'm not going to go over the top 10 because it was so many artists, it's hard to remember them all, but those three are M&A, Kyle, and XXL Tinashes. Now, XXL Tinashes was a given, was more of a, okay, it was either Cardi B or XXL Tinashes, either or, whatever. because I didn't want to pick a 10. So if I had to pick a 10, that was would be it. But Kyle definitely and M&A will be it. Now, here's my thoughts on this cover. Is it one of the best covers? No. Is it a bad cover? No, okay. Sorry. Rewind it. Is it one of the best covers? No. Is it a bad cover? Yes. But in my humble opinion, I feel like this class is a tiny bit better than last year's class. I know a lot of people had a problem with this class, thought it sucked, thought it was trash, thought all of them was garbage, thought all of them has no type of taste, it's just the same old stick, which I complained about last year and the year before, excluding Tink and Vince Staples, excluding them. And did not care for anybody on 2016 class. Me, looking at this class, I'm like, well, I can say this. It's not bad as last year's class. XXL Tinashes was a given. Ugly God, I knew he was going to be on there. Playboy Cardi, I knew he was going to be there. M&A, I knew he was going to be there. Cap G, I heard about him through my coworker. But I'm like, okay, Cap G, okay, that's fine. Okay. See, this I don't want to name them all because I know I'm going to fuck up their names. And that's sad. Let me name the freshman class. I think it's Kamaya. A Boogie with the Hoodie, P and Rock, Triple X Tentacion, Playboy Cardi, Made Into, M&A, Ugly God, Cap G, and Kyle. Those are this year's freshman list. You know. And three out of them people I picked end up being on the cover. I said the Den of Addiction who I think was gonna be on the cover. The reason why I didn't do that, because there was so many artists on that category that we could vote. It was hard to pick which one actually gonna be on the list. But again, it's a cover, pretty bad. Yeah, it's pretty bad. It's really pretty bad. But is it better than last year's class? A little bit, yeah. Now, okay, if I gotta ask myself, okay, well, Jeremiah, why do you think this is a little bit better? Because here's why I think this is a little bit better. Because even though it's a bad class, I kind of like M&A and I kind of like Kyle. They're not all around great lyricists, artists, you know, but they tolerable to listen to. Ugly God, I could never get into. Kamaya, I never necessarily heard. Triple X Tentacion, of course. And then he got that hit song, which that doesn't make fucking sense. Because I went over the lyrics and I'm like, wait, what the fuck? Cap G, didn't listen to. Never heard of. King and Rock, never heard of. A Boogie with a Hoodie, I never heard of. Playboy Cardi, I heard of, but never listened to. And he had that one song that I did skim through from time to time in my life. But yeah. XXL, man, you gotta do better, man. You gotta do better. Or these artists, either you do better or these artists need to do better. Cause I don't know, man. The class is starting to get worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And again, and Devion did agree. 20 and my boy Mo, shout out to Mo. I haven't spoken to him in a while, but we all agreed that 2014 was the last great class. Was the last good class. But if, I know people won't say it was great, or people can say it was just good or decent, but I thought it was the last good class left. That was it. 2015, no. Yeah, it had two people. I liked it, of course, but still no. 2016, I didn't care for nobody. In my opinion. If y'all fuck with these artists, by all means, fuck with your artists. Support them. Fuck with them. Go to their concerts. Blah, 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 blah. But this, when I look at this, yes, it's another bad one. I feel like it's another bad class. But I can necessarily say this is better than last year's class. I can go back and say it's better than last year's. I think, like I said, I feel like the artists, based on who I like, and it's just two artists that I like, you know, is on there. So I can say this is definitely, to me, is better than last year's class. But it's kind of even with the 2015 class. They're like dead even, you know. Dead even. But yeah, that's my thoughts on Freshman List. It's not. It's really not. My final thought is not good, but it's better than last year's. Just keep it simple, you know. But let's see what happened next year, because it. It's only a matter of time, because it's like, you just feel like the freshman list is just getting worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And I thought about it, and I say Joe Budden from Power Struggle, hit the nail on the coffin. I feel like this cover is the only cover that people matters now. This is the only cover that people care about now. This is the only cover. Because nobody go. Okay, of course people read magazines, of course, you know, a lot of people read like magazines and stuff. But when it comes to covers, this is the only cover that people rate and willing to see, want to talk about, give their thoughts, give their rants, give their likes and dislikes on, you know, on certain artists and stuff like that. So, I mean, it came to that. This is the only cover. This is the only urban cover. It's the only urban, you know, magazine that people really care about. In spite of Jet, Vibe, Essence, Ebony. this is the only one that people talk about now. And people necessarily discuss whether you hate the class or you like the class. Or you hate this artist in the class or you hate or you like that artist in the class. It's the only cover that gets people to talk, you know. But, yeah, that's necessarily my thoughts. Other than that, I really don't have anything else. I'm gonna see if me and Devion can do like a BET Award prediction kind of show for next week. Trying to get it before the show starts. But other than that, man, that's another edition of the Enlightened Ignorance Podcast. Thank y'all for listening. I'm sure Devion is very apologetic type of person. He probably will not apologize, even though he's apologetic, because it's super contradiction. But I personally thank y'all for listening to me, and despite my, you know, stutteringness and unfluently-ness, if that's a word, whatever. But y'all bear with me, man. I appreciate y'all. I love y'all from the bottom of my heart. We're gonna keep pushing this thing. We're gonna keep moving this thing, because I believe, and Devion believe, that we can go sky high with our shit. Whether people agree with us, whether people disagree with us, man. And I appreciate the one or two listeners that actually listen to us. I actually thank our 11 followers that we have on SoundCloud. And I think that one or two viewer that listen to us on YouTube. At the end of the day, we have, if we get one person listen to us, that's freaking fine, man. That's freaking fine. It will be nice. It will be, trust me, it will be nice and wonderful if we get freaking 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 as you grow and grow and grow. Trust me, we would love that. We would definitely love that. We would love that. And I feel like we're going to get to that. If we just long keep be push, keep putting content, putting our content out there, and keep, you know, pushing and moving, you know, despite our distance, because he's in Austin, I'm in Houston. Hope he try to get him a job in Houston so he won't have to go over there no more, go back to Austin no more. But, you know, again, I thank y'all. I love y'all. And I don't think I have anything to say. So if you listen to this podcast, I'm not dumb. I'm not stupid. I'm just ignorant who happens to be enlightened by it. This is a, 'cause this is the Enlightened Ignorance Podcast. Check y'all out next week. Peace.